I want to take this opportunity to interact with the man who is really evangelicals and evangelistic and evangelical speaker of the First Order. That's Bishop Tom Wright. His works include, of course, Jesus and the Victory of God. This is a splendid account of the Jesus of history. But the point I want to raise is this. What he describes as Jesus, as we have it in our New Testament, is scarcely the Jesus that I heard about in the Church of England in those days, many years ago now, when I was attending the Church of England. I want to make this point to you very clearly. The Jesus, I repeat, that Tom Wright describes so brilliantly, so lucidly in many of his books, in particular this one, Jesus and the Victory of God, is so terribly alien to the church and Jesus as we know it. For example, the early Christians, Tom Wright says on page 215 of Jesus and the Victory of God, the early Christians spoke of the kingdom quite frequently. That's a grand understatement. Everything they did, Jesus included, who spoke of the kingdom of God as the reason for which he was sent in Luke 4:43. So the Christians and Jesus primarily talked about the kingdom of God incessantly. They were obsessed with it, we might say. And he then says correctly, Bishop Wright says this absolutely spot on, kingdom of God language seems to have functioned as a kind of shorthand summary for the preaching and apologetic message of the church, or indeed for the whole of what Christianity was about. Well, now, listen to sermons carefully today. You will not get the impression that the kingdom of God is what the whole faith is about, the very opposite. Tom Wright describes this as the whole of what Christianity was about, the kingdom of God. That's absolutely right, unarguable. One of those very easy, unarguable facts of the New Testament. Secondly, he says, the God in the phrase kingdom of God had to do with Judaism. The God in question in the phrase kingdom of God, Bishop Wright says, and his cognates, is still without a doubt the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one true God of Jewish monotheism. Well, with great respect, my dear Bishop, what you're promoting in the Church of England as the triune God is not the one God of Judaism. So you here then open the conversation brilliantly for us by asking us to inspect with great attention why it is that Jesus was a Jewish monotheist and why it is that we are not. If we're claiming to follow Jesus, would it be asking too much that we follow his teachings? Then in the section on the great commandment in Mark 12, where Jesus is asked on this occasion by a very friendly Jew, which is the greatest commandment, the one we mustn't get wrong? And of course the answer is the Shema from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Well, the Shema is a unitary, non-Trinitarian proposition. Everybody knows that. That Jew and Jesus agreed. In fact, Tom Wright says, another section in this wonderful book, he says that Jesus' answer about what is the greatest commandment, quoting Deuteronomy 6, of course, Jesus says, the Lord our God is one single Lord. The Lord our God is one person, we might say. Echad in Hebrew, the simple numeral one, which certainly doesn't mean more than one. It means one. Now, one, of course, can modify any noun in the universe. It's completely beyond the point, much worse than that. It's a slippery argument in the extreme to say that one really means more than one. It doesn't. Every Jew knows, and the text is quite clear, that the Shema was a unitary monotheistic proposition. Well, Jesus held that with all the passion that he could manage. So his answer then, Tom Wright says brilliantly and correctly, was completely non-controversial. Of course, they knew who the one God was, and it wasn't the one God of much later Trinitarian theology. And then finally, on page 605 of this wonderful tome, Jesus and the Victory of God, we have this summary and conclusion, which I recommend to everybody listening. Read this carefully. Jesus' beliefs, says Bishop Tom Wright, remained those of a first century Jew committed to the coming kingdom of Israel's God. He didn't waver in his loyalty to Jewish doctrine, but his beliefs were those of a first century Jew who believed that the kingdom was coming in and through him and his work. That's absolutely right. The kingdom of God is everything. From my angle, the kingdom of God has not yet come in the fullest sense. For Bishop Wright, it seems to be largely a thing of the past. For me, it's largely a thing of the future. But he then goes on to say, we can summarize Jesus' beliefs in terms of the three most fundamental Jewish beliefs, monotheism, election, and eschatology. Absolutely right. Jesus believed that there was one God. Of course, that was the Father. The one God of unitary monotheism that all Jews believed and still believe. Finally, Jesus was a first century Jewish monotheist. Well, Bishop Wright, isn't it time for you to begin to follow Jesus by being a first century Jewish monotheist? If the teaching of Jesus has any meaning at all, and apparently it doesn't for many churchgoers, they simply seem to think as long as Jesus died for my sins and rose, that's about it. There's a huge and massive, relentless emphasis in the New Testament on following the words, teachings of Jesus. Salvation, we read in Hebrews 5:9, is given to those who obey Jesus, and he is constantly warning people if we don't listen to his words. Well, what about starting with the Shema, which is non-controversial? What about forgetting the fact that Jesus was later called God? In fact, Bishop Wright says Jesus didn't think he was God. Well, that's amazing. So we're ascribing to Jesus something he didn't believe himself. And here in the South part of the USA, we're making it a crime not to say Jesus is God. That is very far removed from our New Testament. So we take our New Testament into church, clutch it lovingly, and then we proceed to recite a creed about begotten, not made, and eternally begotten, and so on, which has nothing whatsoever to do with the Jewish monotheism that is so patently clear in our Bibles. This calls for a revolution. The Reformation is incomplete. We did not get back behind the church fathers and the very subtle way in which they misled us, in fact. We need to go behind them and go back to Jesus and the apostles and the faith once delivered to the saints.